My name is Jerry Yellin. I was a captain in the Army Air Corps, and I flew P-51s off of Iwo Jima, starting on March 7, 1945, when the Marines took enough land around the first dirt airstrip. I made 19 flights over Japan, starting on April 7, 8 hours in a P-51. And I flew the first mission escorting B-29s, and on August 14, 1945, I flew the very last combat mission of World War II, and my wingman, Phil Schlomberg from Brooklyn, New York, 19 years old, was killed on that day. So he was the last man killed in combat in World War II. I served in World War II. I enlisted as an aviation cadet on February 15, 1942, on my 18th birthday. I was inducted into the service in August of 1942. And I graduated from flying school with 10 hours in a P-40 in August of 1943, was shipped overseas to Hawaii to get 50 more hours in a P-40. But I joined the 78th Fighter Squadron, and I stayed in the 78th right through the war. Flying for your country and flying in combat against an enemy is probably the high point of our life, because we were all young. 10% of the nation served in uniform. The population of America was 16 million people, 160 million people, and 16 million of us served in the military. 8 million young women became Rosie the Riveters and built the airplanes and the tanks and the boats. And the population of America served the nation as well. So everybody was at war. There was a purity purpose, which was to eliminate evil. And we did that. All of us. So the highlight of my life was serving my country in time of war. Well, this is the 70th anniversary of the end of the war, the end of World War II. My wingman, Phil Schlomberg, had an older brother who is now gone, who changed his name, was Michael. Michael had a daughter by the name of Melanie, and the daughter married a Dutch architect by the name of Johansson. And her daughter is Scarlett Johansson, the movie star. And I know that family. And I'm here to pay tribute and honor to Phil Schlomberg, who was the last man killed off of Iwo Jima for the end of the war. And this completes a circle for me. It's a healing day for me, thinking back of all of the people and all the things that we did then that we're not doing now. I came in 2010 for the 65th anniversary, but this is the first time, maybe the last time, that I'll be on Iwo Jima. It's a long trip. I'm 91 years old. I don't know how much time I have left, but it's a day of memories for me. Great memories and sad memories. But I have, in 1988, my youngest son married the daughter of a Japanese kamikaze pilot, which took me from hatred to love of family. I have three Japanese grandchildren. I'd like their contemporaries to know that my grandchildren's grandparents served their countries with honor, no matter what we were learned about the Japanese or what they learned about us, and that war is an atrocity, that evil has to be wiped out. And we are not what we believe. We are all human beings, exactly the same. And there's evil in the world today, and we have to fight that evil to make sure that there's freedom for free-loving people in our world. And you guys in the Marines, the Navy, Air Force, are the ones with that responsibility. And I know you fulfill it well. It means that my cycle of life is near its end. That's what it means to me. And I'm here willingly and happily as a last fond memory of this island, where I flew with 16 guys that didn't come back, and I'm representing them here. I'm the only guy who was a pilot, who's on the island now, who was a pilot in World War II. So I'm representing a lot of people, and I hope I'm doing it humbly and doing it correctly, because we're leaving this world rapidly. And soon, years, there'll be nobody left from World War II. My name is Jerry Yellin, and I served in World War II. one of 16 million who served their nation then. Well, that's just a little bit of the story of my life. Last year, 2016, I asked my granddaughter Sarah, who's 20 years old, Japanese lady, if she wanted to go to Iwo Jima, and she said yes. So I went back to Iwo Jima last year. And do you want to go again? She said yes. So I'm going to meet her in Guam on the 21st of March. And on the 25th of March this year, I'm going back to Iwo Jima, as long as she's alive. It's an interesting story, I think, that should start from the beginning. I was born in 1924 on February 15th. The Depression hit in 1929, and I delivered magazines, Collier magazines and Liberty magazines, in my neighborhood, maybe 6 to 8 houses. And for my prizes, or for my pay, I got coupons, green coupons and brownies, greenies and brownies. And I turned them all in for balsa wood models of World War I airplanes, Spads and Fokkers and the French airplanes. And I made those models. And then when Great Britain went to war, I became a great fan of the English who were fighting for the freedom of the world against Germany. And in 1938 or 39, when General Chenault resigned his commission and took 400 pilots and mechanics to China, the Flying Tigers became my inspiration. And I know Nell Calloway, who runs a museum in Monroe, Louisiana. She's the granddaughter of General Chenault, who ran the Flying Tigers. I was in high school in 1941. I graduated in 1941. I had a full scholarship to college, but no money to support me for food or housing or books. So I went to the school in Trenton Ryder College, and I asked if I could enter school in the spring semester of 1942, rather than the fall semester of 1941. And they said yes. And I was working in a steel mill, Crucible Steel in Harrison, New Jersey. I was working 12 hours a day, 7 days a week, putting $100 a week away so that I could finish my education without working. And on December 7th at 12:30, I listened to the radio and heard about Pearl Harbor. And I made up my mind on that moment that I was going to fly fighter planes against the Japanese. A few days later, I went to the Armory in Newark prior to my 18th birthday. I got the papers. And the sergeant who gave me the papers said to me, "Are you smart?" I said, "Why do I have to be smart?" He said, "Well, you have to have 2 years of college to become a pilot in the Air Corps or pass an equivalent exam." I took the papers home on February 15th, my 18th birthday. I had a meeting with my mother and parents, and they reluctantly signed, after I threatened to sign their names, they signed the papers and I turned them in. The mental examination was easy for me, but I flunked the eye test, as David said. I had 20/30 vision in one eye, and the doctor told me, "Go home, stay in a dark room, eat a lot of carrots, come back in 3 days and take the test again." Well, my mother came home that night. She was working on the draft board. I said, "Could you bring me the eye chart?" And I memorized the eye chart, and I passed the exam. I was inducted into the service at Fort Dix in August of 1942. I went to pre-flight. I went to Nashville, Tennessee for classification. You could be classified a navigator, a bombardier, or a pilot, and you had a choice. And I qualified for all three. I chose to be a pilot, so I went to Santa Ana, California for pre-flight. My mother played mahjong with some ladies in New Jersey who knew someone who moved to California, and they introduced me to a young lady by the name of Doris Rosen. And we dated on the weekends that I could get a Sunday off, maybe four or five times. On February 22nd, which was yesterday, 1943, I soloed in a Stearman. 250 horsepower, open cockpit airplane with an instructor in it. Everything that you did, the instructor did first, and you emulated the instructor. Graduated from primary, went to basic in Tucson, Arizona, at Marana Army Air Base in a 450 horsepower engine Volte vibrator, an enclosed cockpit, no retractable landing gear, but with a radio. Learned how to learn the Morse code, learned how to navigate flying the beam. Da-da, da-did, A-N-N. Passed that, went to advanced flying school at Luke Field in an AT-6. 650 horsepower engine with a retractable gear and two 50 caliber machine guns in each wing, 30 caliber machine gun. Went to gunnery school in Gila Bend, Arizona, 130 in July of 1943, 130 degrees in the sun. We wore sheepskin lined boots and sheepskin lined gloves to get into the airplane. We double timed wherever we went. And they had Lister bags that put 50-pound blocks of ice in 30 minutes. It was hot water. And we slept at night outside in the rain rather than inside, no air conditioning. And then we were examined for the final 6-4 medical exam, and I flunked the eye test. They changed the chart. I still had 20/30 vision in my eyes, but they changed the chart. And Major Lee, a Chinese doctor, said, well, you've come so far. It was 2 weeks from graduation. We had $250 chit that we took to Goldwater in Phoenix, and I had my uniforms and ready to go. And he said, you've come so far, we'll let you graduate with your class, but you're going to become a transport pilot. I said, sir, I'm a fighter pilot. I've got 10 hours in a P-40. I'm going to fly fighters. He said, not if I have it. Anything to say about it. I said, well, who can change that? I'm 19 years old, standing in front of a major. He said, the Commandant of Cadets, how do you get to see him? You go through a chain of command. What does that mean, a chain of command? He says, you ask me first. Sir, I want to see the Commandant of Cadets. Now I'm standing in front of a chicken colonel, eagle colonel. And he says, what can I do for you, Yellin? I said, sir, I have 20/30 vision in one eye. And they want to put me in transport pilot. So I got 10 hours in a P-40. I'm a fighter pilot. And without a step, he said, anybody's got the balls to come to see me, you're a fighter pilot. I graduated with my class, 43H, and the last 28 guys from R to Z were sent to Hawaii to the 78th Fighter Squadron at Haleiwa. They were flying P-40s off of the metal strip on the north shore of Oahu. And 27 of those guys that I graduated with roomed with other fighter pilots. But I was a Jewish guy. I wasn't good enough, like the black guys with the Tuskegee Airmen, who had to be three times as good just to be even. I found out that because I was Jewish, I had to be three times as good just to be even. But 27 of my buddies roomed with other fighter pilots. I roomed with Marvin Kern and Phil Yanofsky, the two Jewish guys who ran the intelligence division of the 78th Fighter Squadron. We learned how to fly in flying school. We learned how to fly as combat pilots, doing maneuvers with 16 ships, string acrobatics, or slow rolls, gunnery missions. And I became a fighter pilot in the 78th Fighter Squadron. 23 of the guys that we went with moved out They kept five of us, Bob Ruby, Al Sharon, Bob Roseberry, one other guy who washed out, a Hawaiian guy, and I. So the four of us stayed in the 78th Fighter Squadron as permanent cadre. March 10th, 1944, I was flying a P-40 at 8,000 feet over a tow target that was flying, towing a target that was in this position. And you had to go upside down, get in a position to fire your guns and pull through without hitting the shroud line. When I turned the airplane up, the P-40 upside down, I had a runaway prop and my engine froze at 8,000 feet. I had figured out in my mind what I would do if I ever got in trouble in an airplane. Nobody told me how to bail out, nobody told me what to do, but I reasoned within myself that if I got into trouble, I'd get the canopy back, get my straps off, trim it nose down, turn it upside down, and pop the stick, and I'd get sucked out. And I gave myself 3,000 feet to 5,000 feet to try and get the engine started. At 5,000 feet, I did that maneuver, and I sucked myself out of the airplane. And I spent 9 hours in a one-man life raft. It was a very rough day. It took 9 hours for the crash boat to come from Honolulu to pick me up 40 miles off of Kahuku Point, North Shore of Oahu. I got back to the squadron 12, 1 o'clock in the morning. They gave me a shot of liquor. I went to sleep. At 6 o'clock, they're waking me up. And they took me down to the flight line. Jim Tapp was my mentor. He was the best pilot ever in the 7th Air Force. And he put me in his airplane. And I said, sir, it won't start. And he turned the mag switch on it, started. I said, sir, it smells of fuel. He said, take off. And that was the toughest takeoff I ever made in an airplane. And the following morning, I flew the P-40. We got P-47s, we moved from Haleiwa to Stanley Field, Schofield Barracks on the golf course. We moved from there with P-47s to Mokulea, got P-47s. We were assigned to go to Yap as a prelude to MacArthur's invasion of the Philippines. We had a party, we made Bushmaster juice, 78 Fighter Squadron with the Bushmasters. They're gonna celebrate their 100th anniversary in February 2018. I'm booked there 2018, February to speak. But Mark Welsh, who just retired as Chief of Staff, was a Bushmaster. And we expect to have a big turnout in 2018. But anyhow, our planes were at Hickam Field, and we made Bushmaster juice out of pineapple juice and medicinal alcohol. We had parties and ready to go, cut our hair off, and it was an incredible moment. And then that invasion was called off. We were tremendously disappointed, but we moved to Bellows Field and got P-51s, and we were all happy campers again. In December of 1944, or early January of 1945, we flew the 51s to Ford Island. They were loaded onto a Jeep carrier, the Sitco Bay, and we took off, left Ford Island alone. The plan was if we were attacked, we would take all of the Mustangs and push them off the deck, the upper deck, bring them up from below, take off, and fight whomever we were attacked. Fortunately, that never happened. But 3 days out to sea, we were called into a briefing room and shown a relief map of a small island called Iwo Jima. The Marines were going to invade Iwo Jima, 650 miles from Japan, midway between Guam, Saipan, and Tinian, where the bombers, the B-29s, we're flying 16-hour missions over Japan and losing 40 to 50% of their airplanes to the Japanese, to weather, and to problems, mechanical problems. On February 19th, 67,000 American Marines landed on Iwo Jima, fighting against 23,000 Japanese who were not on Iwo Jima, but were in Iwo Jima. They had enough land to protect us, so on March 6th and March 7th, the 15th Fighter Group landed on the dirt airstrip, Motoyama 1, at the foot of Mount Suribachi. I landed on March 7th. And when I landed and stopped rolling, I smelled a smell that I had never smelled before. Actually, there were 28,000 bodies rotting in the sun over time on Iwo Jima, and the sights and the sounds and the smells of war are with me to this day, 72 years later, after I landed on Iwo Jima. It never went away. For 30 days, we strafed for the Marines, and then on April 7th, 1945, the top 16 pilots in our squadron, I was maybe the eighth or ninth ranking pilot, were assigned to fly an escort mission of B-29s over Japan. It was an 8-hour round-trip mission, 225-gallon external tanks. We flew up on our external tanks. We got to a rally point, dropped our tanks, picked up the B-29s. We had to focus our gun cameras on a stationary target, either the tip of a cloud or the tip of a mountain. And I remember focusing my gun camera on the tip of Mount Fuji, the symbol of Japan. We watched as the B-29s made a big square of fire, a large square of Tokyo, and then 150 B-29s dropped their bombs into the fire, and small fires became big fires, and square miles of Tokyo were burning. Not once did it occur to me that there were human beings on the ground. The atrocities of war from the air, the atrocity of wars that I saw on the ground were memorable. I saw Marines with their penises cut off, stuck in their mouth by the Japanese. I saw Marines with their faces bashed in and their teeth pulled out to get the gold. All of that made me think that there was no humanity attached to the Japanese, and we were killing our enemy. That's the pure purpose of war, is to kill your enemy. Jim Tapp became the first ace over Japan. He shot down four zeros on April 7th and his fifth zero on April 12th and was the first ace over Japan. I lost three wingmen. I flew with 16 guys who didn't come back. Five guys were killed in training in Hawaii. I can tell you their names, not necessary. 11 guys were killed in combat over Japan. I lost three wingmen. Dick Stropel was following me. I was leading an eight-ship drop of 500-pound bombs on Chichijima. They were shooting at me to hit Stropel. He got out of his plane, got into a one-man riffraff, got into a Dumbo that we had, dropped by a B-17, and then a PBY with a doctor landed next to that crash boat, saw that he was dead, and we had to sink that ship with rockets so that the Japanese wouldn't get his body on Chichijima. And that was in March, April of 1945. And then I was shot down at zero with Danny Mathis from North Augusta on May 30th. He was my wingman. We shared a kill. And I had a toothache when I landed on Iwo Jima, and they grounded me. And they gave Danny Mathis my airplane, the Dari R. I named it after Doris Rosen on June 1. And I have a picture of me briefing him because he's going to fly as an element leader on a B-29 raid over Osaka. An hour after that picture was taken, the squadron took off. And an hour after they took off, they were led into a front by a Yardbird B-29 navigating pilot. And 27 fighter planes went down in a mid-air collision. 27 fighter planes, single engine, one pilot. 22 guys bailed out, 25 guys were killed, including Danny Mathis in my airplane. And I didn't miss Danny, I missed my airplane more than I missed him, which was quite a sickness. sick feeling. I didn't have an airplane to fly. And then on August 13th, after the two bombs, I was strafing airfields over Tokyo on August 6th. And when I landed, my prop was still spinning, and Phil Maher from Brooklyn jumped on my wing and said, "It's over. We dropped a bomb on Tokyo, on Hiroshima, wiped out a whole city." I said, "What are you drinking? I want some." But it was true. And then on the 9th of August, Nagasaki was bombed. We didn't think we were going to fly again, but on the 13th of August, we were called to a briefing room, and Jim Tapp was our CO, a full colonel then, and he said, "We're going to go on a mission over Japan." Actually, we stopped escorting B-29s in June of 1945 because Curtis LeMay came from Europe when the war ended and stopped the daylight bombing of the B-29s because of the casualty rate. And he went up at night. So we went up on strafing missions, on just missions of shooting rockets and strafing airfields and factories and whatever targets we could find, shipyards and that. So we did those missions. And on the 13th, we were told we were going to go on another mission. Someone asked Tapp, "Why are we going?" He said, "Well, the Japs are negotiating, but they're not responding fast enough. So we're going to go up and keep them honest. But they're going to broadcast the code word Ohio on our way up." We had B-17s in the air, PBYs in the air. We had destroyers on the surface and submarines near Tokyo, all tuned in to one of our five radio stations. We had five tube radios, A, B, C, D, and E. The D channel was the emergency channel, and that was a channel that all of the airplanes in the sky and the ships on the sea were tuned into. They're going to broadcast the code word Ohio. When he said that, my wingman, Phil Schleinberg, was 19 years old, graduated from NYU at the age of 15, became a pilot at the age of 18. And he was 19 years old. He said, "Captain, if we go, I'm not coming back." I said, "What are you talking about, Phil?" He says, "It's a feeling I have." I told that to Tapp, and he said, "If Jerry, you can't go to Doc Lewis, the flight surgeon, but if you tell Schlumberg to go, Doc Lewis might be able to get him a replacement." And I told that to Schlumberg. He said, "No way, I'll go." On the morning of the 14th, I briefed him, "Just stay on my wing. We're never going to make it to Tokyo. They're going to call it off before we get there." That didn't happen. We dropped our wing tanks. We went in. We strafed airfields. We needed 90 gallons of fuel to get back to Iwo Jima from Japan. We could cut our engine consumption back to 20 or 22 gallons an hour. Somebody called 90 gallons in the 78th Fighter Squadron. I looked over. I gave a thumbs up to Schlumberg. He gave me a thumbs up. And I led my flight into some pretty heavy weather on the way out to sea to pick up the B-29. When I came out in clear skies, Schlumberg was gone. There was no visual, there was no radio call. And when we landed on Iwo Jima on that day, we found out that while we were strafing, the war had been over for 3 hours. I came home in October of 1985, and I took Schlumberg's wings, medals, lieutenant bars to his mother in Brooklyn. He had four or five sisters. They were there. He had a brother, Michael. He wasn't there, didn't want to meet me. And when I left that house that night, his mother said to me, "I hope it should have been you, Captain, who was killed, not my son, Philip. I hope you never sleep a night like I can't sleep." And I stood on that porch for an hour, 2 hours, before I stopped shaking and drove back to Newark. The first 30 years of the war were dismal for me. I couldn't work. I spoke to the 16 guys every night. I thought about suicide. I met a woman by the name of Helene Schulman on Good Friday, 1949. We got engaged on Memorial Day and married on October 22nd, 1949. I was the father of four sons. I moved 15 or 16 times trying to find work, and I couldn't do it. I moved to Israel I played golf a lot. I gambled a lot on a golf course. And in 1965, I played in the Maccabee Games, which are the Jewish Olympics the year after the International Olympics. And I played on a golf team in 1966. I moved to Israel with my wife and four sons, and I played golf. And she tried to commit suicide. She took every pill in the house, and I found her 6 months after we were moving there. When she recovered, we went to Eilat, and I said, I made a commitment to you for the rest of your life and the rest of my life, but if you do that again, I'll break my commitment. And we went back to the United States. In 1975, she saw Maharishi Mahesh Yogi on the Merv Griffin TV show, and she learned Transcendental Meditation in July of 1975, and I learned in August of 1975, and I got my life back instantaneously. I became a consultant. I was a builder, and I became a consultant to the major banks in California, Bank of California, Bank of America, Wells Fargo. And these were the days of the REITs, the Real Estate Investment Trust. And they asked me to go to Japan in 1983. I looked at the guy who was crazy. You know, Japan is not a place. Japanese are not people. I said, I can't go, I'm too busy. I went home that night in September 1983, and I said to Helene, I just had an opportunity to go to Japan, but I turned it down. And she looked at me. She said, Jerry, you never asked me if I wanted to go to Japan. So in October 1983, I went to Japan. It was a life-transforming experience because I saw human beings. I saw culture, education, scenery, ate the food. It was an incredible experience. I had to do my business in Tokyo and get out of the city because I looked up through the buildings and I saw the B-29s coming down, me visualizing them from when I saw them in 1945, but they now were dropping the bombs on me and I had to go out in the countryside. And we were staying at the old Miyako Hotel in Kyoto on the last night of a 16-day trip. And she said to me, Jerry, you know Robert would love Japan. Robert was the fourth of our four sons. He was a senior at San Diego State. And we came home, she said, we should give him a trip to Japan for graduation. I said, that's a good idea. So he came home, I said, Rob, we want to give you a trip overseas to go for your graduation. You got a 1% chance of getting it. If you go to Europe, you got a 99% chance of going if you accept Japan. He said, okay, I'll go to Japan. He had no idea what he wanted to do. He went to Japan in 1984, early 1984, or late 1983, and on a 6 weeks homestay, came home, graduated from college in 1984, and took a job teaching English in Japan for 1 year. And now it's 2017, he hasn't come back yet. In 1987, he asked us to come to Japan. He said, Dad, you pay for the airfare. I'll take care of everything else in Japan. And we went there. He told me where the key to the house was. We went to his house by cab in Numazu. About 30 minutes after we were there, a young lady walked in. She made us tea, sitting on the floor eating tea. I'm looking at this Japanese lady. And I said, was your father in the war? And she said, yes. I said, what did he do? She said, I don't know. He never talked about it. Robert came home. We went out to a big, big restaurant with fish tanks all around the restaurant. He said, Dad, you want to eat some sushi? I'd never had any sushi. I said, if you'll eat it, I'll eat it. He says, you mean that? I said, yeah, sure. He says, you want to bet? I said, absolutely. How much? $10. Okay, you got to bet. He speaks to the waiter about 15 minutes later. There are three shrimp this big, head on, tail on, squiggling on my plate and squiggling on his plate. And he takes a shrimp, takes the head off, pops that squiggling thing into his mouth, and eats it. And I said, you win. Well, that's called Ama Ebi. It really is delicious. I eat it now whenever I can get it, which is rare in America. And he told us on the last night that we were there that he and Takako wanted to get married. And I saw the faces of the 16 guys that I flew with flash through my mind. But I had the sensibility to ask him, what does her father say? And he said he won't meet me. And I said, will you get married if you don't get the family permission? He said, we haven't reached that point yet. She was the youngest of four children. She had three older brothers. 7 months later, after we met Takako, Robert and Takako, two of her older brothers and her father met in a Chinese restaurant that the father chose because he didn't know that Robert could sit on the floor and eat. And in Japan, you eat in a Chinese restaurant on a chair and in front of tables. And the two boys grilled my son mercilessly about his religion, his spirituality, his ability to make a living, and made him promise out loud that if the wedding took place, that he would never, ever move their sister to America away from her family. And he did that. And the father, when he spoke, asked my son 5 questions. How old is your father? 63. Was he in the war? Yes. What did he do? He was a pilot. What did he fly? P-51s. Where? Over Japan. And that ended the meeting. This man was a kamikaze pilot with 500 friends. And he and one other man were sent to China to serve as zeros. The other man was killed by a B-29 raid. And he alone, of the 500 kamikaze pilot, was the sole survivor of that group of people. And he went home that night and said to his wife, make the wedding. And she went freaking ballistic, screaming at him. She said, for 43 years, you've been telling me how much you hate the Americans, that you never fired a bullet against them, that you didn't die for the emperor. And now you want our daughter to marry this full-bearded American gaijin foreigner? And he said, yes. And she said, why? And he said, any man that could fly a P-51 against the Japanese and live must be a brave man. And I want the blood of that man to flow through the veins of our grandchildren. And so on March 5th, 1988, 2 days shy of 43 years to the day that I landed on Japanese soil on Iwo Jima, I saw my son, looking like a Japanese man in a Japanese outfit, marry the daughter of a Japanese kamikaze pilot. We went to the ryokan, Arai, in Shimoda, Japan. He and I, Mr. Yamakawa and I, and a translator. And we spoke for 3 hours through a translator, deep speak, really deep speak. And when we came out of that, he said to the translator that he never knew that there were other people in the world that believed what he believed about education and family, social things, religious things. And it was repeated to me in English, and we bonded. I couldn't speak Japanese. He spoke very little English. And we became family. Robert found names for our grandchildren. I have 3 Japanese grandchildren. Names in Japanese that we could use in English. Kentaro is a Japanese name. 2 syllables, Ken and Taro. 2 symbols. Kentaro is 27 years old. He graduated with a master's in physics from Hokkaido University, which is the MIT of Japan, and was one of 20,000 applicants for 100 jobs in a prestigious company. He got one of the 100 jobs. His brother Simon, S-A-I-M-O-N, 2 Japanese characters called Simon, which was my father's name, was sent to school at the University of City of London
and philosophy. He graduated from UC London in 3 years, a four-year course, and was awarded a full-year scholarship at Oxford to get a master's in philosophy, which he graduated from in 1 year. So he went through 6 years of college with a master's in philosophy from Oxford, and now works for a university in Kobe. In 2015, Fuji TV came to Fairfield, Iowa to interview me for a documentary they were making about World War II, 70th anniversary of the end of World War II. And the man spoke perfect English. And I said, "Where did you learn English?" He said, "At the Tokyo School of Foreign Studies." I said, "Interesting, my granddaughter Sarah goes there." When he got through interviewing me in Iowa, he went back, went to the school, found Sarah, and asked her what she wanted to do when she graduated. She said, "I want to be a journalist, a reporter, a writer." And he said, "How would you like to go to Iowa for Fuji TV and interview your grandfather?" She said, "I'd love to." So she came to Iowa and interviewed me. And she's Sara, S-A-R-A, two Japanese characters, now 21 years old. And those are my Japanese family. From them, I learned more than I could ever teach my children. I learned that we are not what we see or not what we believe. We are all human beings together in life. The sperm of any man, sperm of a Jewish man, fertilized the egg of a Buddhist woman and gave me three Japanese grandchildren. I come here humbly to serve you as I served my country with 16 million of us in World War II. Because you who put the uniform on, you who defend our country. In 1936, the headlines in America were about racial problems in America, about religious problems in the world, people willing to kill other people for what they believed. In 2016, 2017, the racial problems still exist in our country. There are people who believe in things that they're willing to kill for what they believe. But the difference is science. I'm told by the major people in the military that the smallest nuclear weapon in the American arsenal is 1,000 times bigger than the bombs that were dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. I'm concerned about two things. One is global warming, which will destroy the Earth's ability to sustain life. And the other is nuclear warfare, which will wipe out, should it ever occur, the ability of our Earth to sustain life. And you who serve our country in uniform, you are the only protection that the world has against nuclear warfare. I made a commitment to my country and to my buddies, people I flew with, people I served with. I was willing to give my life to protect them. They were willing to give their life to protect me. And you who serve in uniform, along with the policemen and the firemen, in the line of duty of what you do every day, are prepared to do exactly that. And I honor you for that. You are the front line of the defense of the world as it exists today. And it's my honor to be a part of what you do. In 2013, 2014, I lived in Fairfield, Iowa. My wife passed away in June of 2015 after 65 years of marriage. And I was the cause of most of her debilitation, most of her illness, and I didn't know that. But in 2013, 2014, these two fingers of mine were turning white from lack of circulation. And I went to my local doctor and he said, "We can't take care of you. You have to go to Burlington, Iowa, 50 miles away, to see a cardiologist. And they made an appointment for me to be there at 1:20 in the afternoon at a cardiology clinic at the Burlington Hospital. I walked in and they were all foreign named doctors. And I asked the nurse, who am I going to see? She said, you're going to see Dr. Al-Wadani. I said, where's Dr. Al-Wadani from? She said, Palestine. Now, I'm a Jewish guy who lived in Israel. I'm really not a fan of Netanyahu and what he's doing, what's going on there today. And I said, I'm going to say something to this doctor. So I'm in his office. I said, Dr. Al-Wadani, what's your first name? He said, Abdullah. I said, may I call you Abdullah? He said, absolutely. I said, Abdullah, I lived in Israel, and really I'm disturbed about what Netanyahu's doing with the territories in Palestine and what's going on. And he stood up and glared at me and pointed his finger at me. He said, you have no idea who we are or what we are. He's 42 years old, brilliant, young, head of a five department, cardiology department. Sat down, finished examining me, prescribed something, said, you have to come back here in 10 days. I got up to leave, and he said, wait a minute, Mr. Yellin. And I said, call me Jerry. He said, do you know what my hobby is? I said, I don't know what your friggin' hobby is. How would I know? He said, my hobby is World War II. And I've read every single book that I can find about World War II. But you, sir, are the first man I've ever met who served in World War II. So I stayed there talking to him 15, 20, maybe 30 minutes about World War II. I was gigantically impressed by this guy, Abdullah Al-Wadani, and I went home. Now, I had a scale model of my P-51. Paint job, black and white wingtips, yellow spinner, 134, the Dari R, the Bushmaster on the side. I packed it up and I mailed it to him, sent it to him. 10 days later, I'm back in his office. He's waiting for me in the reception room, takes me into his private office. My airplane sitting on his desk. He's making rounds, comes back, sits down and looks at me. He said, you know, Jerry, you touched my heart like few people in the world ever touched my heart. And he reached into his pocket and he pulled out Muslim prayer beads. He said, my father carried these until he died when he was 72 years old. And I want you to have these. And he handed me Muslim prayer beads. And I looked at the beads and I looked at him and I said, Abdullah, this is a family heirloom. This belongs to your children, your grandchildren. I want you to have these beads. So you had a Jewish guy carrying Muslim prayer beads, telling that story wherever I went about the sameness of we as human beings. And it's true. We're all human beings in nature. From my perspective at 93, the birds, the bees, the trees, the worms, the tigers, the lions, the rabbits, the human beings have one purpose in life. That's to recreate ourselves. I'd like to ask everybody in this room, how many of you have gone to recreation school? Comes with nature. We're all part of nature. If we can have the world understand that, we might have peace in the world. Thank you so much for allowing me to be here. What an honor. I always thought flying for my country was the best, but this cannot be beat for me. Thank you so much again. Any questions? Any questions at all? Yes.
Tell us the role
I'm sorry?
The role that transcendental meditation plays in your life today?
You know, there's 22 suicides a day, I'm told, by the Iraqi Afghanistan veterans. Our government is spending $8 billion dollars a month for antipsychotic and antidepressant drugs. And I'm told that I can teach or have veterans learn transcendental meditation, any veteran, for $720, a one-time fee for a lifetime of help. That $8 billion a month is going to escalate and go on for 600 or 700 months for the young people who are serving today. And I urge you, if you want to learn TM, look up tm.org on the internet. Look up The Last Bomb on the internet. You'll see a story of B-29s and P-51s. You'll see me taking off from Iwo Jima. Go to pbs.org and buy the video Iwo Jima from Combat to Comrades and see what Iwo Jima was really like by a government film, a film made for the government. And think about what I thought about. And my life changed dramatically when I was 13 years old. I read a book by a minister called Lloyd C. Douglas. The book was called The Magnificent Obsession. It's the story of a small town of 250 people on either Lake George or Lake Champlain, where a doctor, 70-year-old doctor, is having a heart attack, and the scion, the son of the wealthiest family, is drowning. And the fire department has one resuscitator, and they save the young man, and the old doctor dies. And thousands of people come to his funeral, and his family can't understand that they were all bringing gifts. And they found a journal that he'd written in code. When it was decoded, the opening line of that journal said this: "Do something good for someone else every day of your life and tell no one about it, because by talking about what you did, you use up the good that might have inured to the person that you did it for and to yourself. So be kind to somebody every day of your life. Give yourself away a little bit to someone else every day and find the pleasure that you get out of life. Our life is not about collecting things. Our life is about service to each other. And you who are in uniform understand that. Most of the population today, including my children and my grandchildren, are about me. But life in reality is all about us, you. Again, thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Yellin.